Jaden Daniels said it was the most hostile environment the Sun Devils have seen since traveling to East Lansing 2 years ago, and they fall to the BYU Cougars in Provo 27-17, dropping their record to 2-1 and ending the non-conference portion of the schedule. I'm Zach Keenan, joined by our publisher for DevilsDigest.com, Hode Rubino, on the field at Lavelle Edwards Stadium. And Hode, after this one, I think the first thing we have to discuss is the noise. 61,000 fans at Lavelle Edwards Stadium. I'm not sure the last time ASU saw a crowd of that size.
Yeah, J.D. Daniels said it was last time. It was Michigan State back in 2019, which seems like 1,000 years ago with everything that's happened since then. But I just think that maybe the prevailing disappointment over here is a very veteran ASU team playing anything but a veteran ASU team. 16 penalties for over 130 yards. If some of those penalties were actually accepted by BYU, additional penalties, I should say, it'd probably be much closer to 20. Really just a big-time lack of discipline on both sides of the ball. Yes, the crowd noise caused, I believe, it was three false starts when ASU was pinned very close to their own end zone. But Herm Edwards talked about this being embarrassing, talked about inexcusable. Defensive coordinator Antonio Pierce said that there will be consequences for those offenders. So maybe when the next game rolls by, we might actually see the results of the consequences. But absolutely amazing in every negative way to see ASU shoot itself in the foot time and time again, four turnovers. Two interceptions by Jaden Daniels, one of the most sure-handed quarterbacks not in the Pac-12 in the entire country. Never had a game where he had two interceptions in one game. Not all the BYU touchdowns, but two out of three BYU touches in the first half were scored off the turnovers. And one turnover, by the way, was just Jordan Porter returning a kick out of the end zone, which you probably shouldn't return to begin with. Fumbles the ball, and BYU goes 12 yards. And scores their first touchdown, and really seemed for a while they were setting the tone with that early miscue. Granted, I think the defense didn't play all that bad for some stretches of the first half. They actually pitched three and outs right after that score, but the offense was able to capitalize, like I said, to two interceptions in the second quarter, and it really just was an uphill climb for ASU, and just a wacky game for so many reasons. If you told me that BYU was going to score only 6 points in the second half and almost in a garbage time touchdown, if you will, that ASU would not come out victorious, I would say you're absolutely out of your mind. But when there's so many miscues, so much lack of discipline from the Sun Devil team, the result is probably not surprising at all.
Arizona State with just 3 points in the second half. Hode, you said it was wacky. I mean, even in the times when ASU seemed like they had control of the game, Merlin Robertson picks off a pass, returns it almost the entire length of the field, and Algier strips him of the ball, fumble, BYU gets it. Even when ASU felt like they were ahead, it felt like they were also behind. What a strange game. So let's take a look at the offense. It seemed like so many times Jaden Daniels spent a lot of time in the pocket after taking the snap. Did he have receivers open downfield?
Well, I think Jaden Daniels, passing-wise, it wasn't a horrible game. I mean, sure, he had the two interceptions, sure. But he did pass for 265 yards. I don't believe that he passed for that many yards the entire 2020 season. I mean, I have to look back at the numbers. Maybe there's one game that isn't close to that. But when you and I talked so many times about the passing game, even going back to spring practice on how much that fascinating needs to get on track, it was really one step forward, two step backs for the passing game. You have the two interceptions, but ASU really in the air was really having their way with this BYU secondary. Problem was BYU was really having their way with the ASU secondary, and that to me is probably the more surprising element of this game. When you have such a veteran secondary, combined 131 starts, only second in the nation behind Indiana, you don't expect the BYU team, who really is bread and butter of the offense, is a running game, to really punish ASU in the air as much as they did. But because we're able to achieve that, that really, really hurt ASU quite a bit. And again, you got the penalties, and sure, you got the offense again shooting itself in the foot time and time again with the penalties. But I think BYU was really able to have a very, very balanced offense when it was all said and done. Even though the rushing game for the Cougars was really quiet in the first half, it really got on track second half. And ASU, ironically, really had the same element working in their favor. Daniel Nada, who really didn't come healthy into this game, did not play the whole first half, had, I think, on his own about over 80 yards rushing just in the third quarter, and things really started clicking for ASU when you really thought that a comeback might have been in sights. But you mentioned the Marlon Robinson, an interception, which I guess he did step out of bounds. I can't say that I really saw that play on TV. So bad luck here for ASU because Tyler Gill, the running back for BYU, was able to strip the ball. And like I said, BYU recovered. And that to me was just like the microcosm of this whole game when you look at it that way. So again, it's just one of those things where just when you thought the offense was getting a little on track, just when you thought the defense was really getting on the track, here comes a penalty. Here comes another turnover. Just like it's one of those games that really, really was meant to be. Obviously, you give a lot of credit to BYU. I mean, they really definitely deserve to win this game. But I think that every BYU player knows very well when they're going to look at this film, they're going to see an opponent that in many ways, whether it's penalties or turnovers, really, really handed them one opportunity after another. They took advantage of it in the first half very well. Maybe not so great in the second half, but they did just enough to win ASU, and then they did win it rightfully. When ASU has that many mishaps, total lack of discipline on both sides of the ball, then do not deserve to win the game, and here they are.
Well, yeah, we'd love to draw some more positives out of this game, but unfortunately, just not too many. You look at special teams. Christian Zendejas nailed a 40-yard field goal. That must have been good for confidence, right, especially in the kicking game.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think Christian Zendejas just really rejoining the team just last week and being called upon to kick a field goal that wasn't a chip shot like he had a 22-yarder the week before. Yes, I think it's definitely a confidence builder. But if you're trying to look at any kind of silver lining here, Zach, it was a non-conference team. And sure, it's a bummer that ASU, instead of vaulting to the top 15 right now, is probably going to drop out of the top 25, but it was a non-conference game. And Pac-12 slate starts. They're starting 0-0, unlike USC, for example. They're playing a Colorado team that absolutely got trounced at home 30-0 by Minnesota. So I'm not saying ASU is coming in with any swagger into Sun Devil Stadium a week from tonight, but Colorado is definitely not brimming with confidence at all. And you'd like to see ASU not only get the win, but really also clean up a lot of mistakes. And I think Colorado, and I don't want to sound pompous after what I saw over here, but I think the Buffaloes might be just what the doctor ordered for a Sun Devil team that's really trying to rebounding, really trying to start Pac-12 slate on the right foot. But make no mistake about it, ASU has a lot to clean up. And the lack of discipline was really appalling tonight. It was really appalling in the first game against Southern Utah, where they had over 120 yards of penalty. And obviously, the only common denominator is Southern Utah and BYU do belong to the same state. But obviously, they are two different caliber of football teams altogether. They could probably get away with how they played against Southern Utah, maybe against UNLV, the way ASU played today. But when you play a team of the caliber of BYU, absolutely, you are going to get punished and punished dearly for those miscues. And that's why ASU right now did come back come out with the first loss of the season. But right now, it's all Pac-12 game. Pac-12 games. They do have an opportunity to really start this out on the right foot, but there's a lot to clean up, and I think it's really logical and understandable to wonder if they can clean up so many aspects in so little time because they're playing Colorado a week from tonight.
That's something about those Utah games. We'll be back here in the state of Utah in Salt Lake City again in a month as ASU takes on its third opponent from the Beehive State, the University of Utah. But in the meantime, as the Sun Devils drop to 2-1, they'll head back home to Tempe and take on the Colorado Buffaloes at home next Saturday. In the meantime, for DevilsDigest.com, I'm Zach Keenan, our publisher, Hode Rubino, and we'll see you again soon.